Phillips. Many of you guys know me. I've met a lot of you. Hey, what's up? Man, your hair got long. Whoa. It's great to see people's different hairstyles. I have the same one. Always. I just get more wrinkles all the time. But I've been living in China, so maybe my skin's aging faster now. I don't know. Maybe the pollution's affecting me or affecting my judgment. Probably both. So I'm going to give a new talk that I've been kind of honing for a little while, talking about creating in the cloud and some realidad, a.k.a. reality, about what we're all developing. I've been feeling this kind of like grinding in my mind over doing development, desktop development, and just in my own personal trajectory, doing way more web development all the time and finding it as more rewarding. So I'm trying out this Google Present, so we'll see how this works. So I just quick survey, like who uses, what do you use for your email now? What application do you use? Do you use Evolution? Thunderbird? How about for your like hosting? Your like email hosting? Gmail, right? It's like who doesn't use Gmail here? All right, who uses Gmail as a backup? Okay, see, yeah, right, yeah, exactly. But also, like, what do you use for your blogging? Do you still host that on your own? Do you use, or do you use, like, WordPress? Anybody use WordPress? Use it on your site. Anybody use, like, WordPress.com? Or, like, a hosted solution? No? Well, you use your own place. What about photos? Where do you host your photos at? Do you just keep them on your hard drive? You do? You just have like a big folder? On the web. Does anyone use Flickr?
I have a Flickr account.
Does anybody like care about like synchronization? Do you ever like synchronize your hard drive? Like try to use that conduit thing that never works? It never works, does it? It's like, what is that thing? Why use it? So, you know, Dave was talking about this idea yesterday of like this web operating system. And the more I think about it, it's like this already exists, right? It already exists. It is the goal, right? The long-term goal. And I don't know if you guys think about this. I always think, I'm like, okay, like what's the trajectory? Like what are we doing here? Like everything I'm doing is on the web. Like I don't even need my computer anymore. I could just like, somebody could come up here and like smash it and I'll just go open another one and just keep working. It doesn't really matter as much anymore. The web operating system is the web. The operating system is the web. And we have like all these new web browsers that are becoming more stable all the time, like Google Chrome, Firefox, that allow for this to happen. And just as a side note, what I'd really like to have, I just want a netbook or I want a tablet that just has like a web browser. That's it. And then we can let people like Ann Holt like focus on making the graphics awesome and making it very solid on that front. But I was thinking, these are my parents. I'm like, what do most people use? What are the common people, commoners? Not the creative commoners, but what do the commoners use? Like your friends. Because I guarantee you, like probably like most of you people here, your friends are using Gmail or Hotmail for their email, not like their own hosted solution. Especially your non-technical friends, right? So what are the common people using? How is this affected? So what you find out now is that you really want your data in all these different devices, different locations, but you also want it to be secure. You want it to be somewhere secure. And just because something's on the web doesn't mean it's not backed up or redundant. I actually trust Google more with my data than I trust myself at this point. Because my computer developed a nice little like cough, and I'm getting a little worried about it. But I never find the time to back it up. It's like I don't know. Like maybe I'm lazy. Maybe I'm not enough of a hacker. But common people want a lazy solution. This is why so many people here in the audience, like Nate, have Macs. Right? You can just run like Time Machine and just like backs it up. You don't have to worry about it. You don't have to like configure a bunch of scripts. So where is our data at? This is the question that we're all concerned with more than many people. Where is it at? And also, like, what can another company or entity that's hosting the data do with this? Like, what do the terms of service say? And also, what is the practice at hand? Maybe companies or organizations actually violate their own agreement. Like, what legal teeth do we have if we use some sort of hosted solution? What can we do about it? So I started thinking a lot more about this because some of you probably know I'm like massively into like microblogging. You know, as Chris Lilly asked me, he's like, I thought when I saw you, you were going to speak in hashtags. I was like, well, okay, sorry, that's kind of bad. But no, actually one of my friends the other night said, hey, John, nobody knows what you're talking about. I was like, oh no, I've got like a disease, like microblogging speak. But yeah, I was kind of actually worried. I was like, oh no, I can't talk to the common man now. This is a problem. But so I started using Twitter, and Twitter started developing these like hiccups called fail whale, right? Many of you have seen this graphic, and it's really horrible, actually. At first, it's kind of funny, but then when you're a company and people start developing pop culture paraphernalia, you've got a problem on your hands, you know? It's like, okay, it's funny, but okay, now it's not funny because your service just sucks. And so this guy here, Evan Prodromo, who lives in Montreal, I'm actually staying at his house, he came up with a great solution. He's from Wiki Travel fame. So if you want to find out about Montreal, you know, you can go to like Wiki Travel and, you know, find out where you can get the best poutine at. You guys know what poutine is, right? All right. Yeah, we can go get one later and like, it's like, you know, putting a cork in your heart. Kind of like that, you know, like French fries and oil and anyway. So he started this and he has a really good background in doing a web startup, but also around open source and free software. So he launched a service called Identica. And Identica is a Twitter clone that is based upon free software and free network definition. It also has a specification. So if you wanted to take it and set up your own instance, you could do that and network it together. It's better. It's scaled. It's scalable. But you can also connect it in with all your other network. Like for me, like I use a service called Ping FM, and I just send all my like updates through that, and then it just basically spams everything from there. Oh wait, I didn't say spam. I mean broadcast my status to all these different services from there, including Identica. So this whole move towards free network services is this autonomous network services, free network services. And it comes out of course, like the free software movement and wanting these freedoms, but on the network. And this is basically a solution of free software plus free network services, and then some other things sprinkled in, because free is not enough, you know? Because when you're in the cloud, you're using other people's PCs. That's a hip-hop reference if anybody kind of gets that. Okay, anyway. You're not down with that? I am. No. There's terms of service, right? There's other things other than just data. There's the licenses. Maybe collaboration. Maybe you want to have other types of agreements as well. Maybe commercial agreements. How's that governed? What we really need is we need autonomy in the cloud. We need some sort of, we need rights, basically. We need service providers to provide this. So some of you might have read about this Franklin Street Declaration, which is a statement about free network services and how they should be used. So let's think of it in three areas, right? Developers. So for developers, that's us. Most of us here are developers, I think. Even users are developers in my book. Use the GNU Afero GPL license, which is a provision for network services and being able to get to source code. You can also attain a similar thing if you use GPL by making a statement about it and or providing similar functionality. Create free services to replace popular non-free ones, right? What about Flickr? Do we have this kind of this Can we access Flickr's source code? No, we can't. But I would also take it a step further, because I was working for Creative Commons for the last 3 years, and I've stepped back from that. And part of my job there was convincing businesses to use Creative Commons licenses, right? So it's not always effective just to reinvent the wheel, as we all know, you know? Like, if we'd started, like John Cruise and I, you know, if like we'd started Inkscape and it was like, you know, just started from scratch, we would not be anywhere, right? But we built on top of other code that allowed us to do something great. Similarly, we should give options to businesses and organizations, try to convince them to use this Franklin Street Declaration as a basis for their services. But it's also an uphill battle, so you don't have to like waste all your energy on that. If we want to make something new, make something new. And then third, replace centralized services with open distributed ones, if possible. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean like P2P, right? You know, P2P is not the solution to everything in the world. Backups, redundancy, this is important. Or being able to have a federated service, maybe like with the open microblogging specification. This is a good model. Having a specification and a service that allows federation. And I'm not talking Star Trek, which opens today. Yeah. I heard some like real nerds like talking about this last night. Actually, oh no, wait, it wasn't nerds, it was the people I'm staying with. Evan and his wife. His wife is going to see Star Trek IMAX while he watches the kids. I was like, what? What universe am I in? Jeez. Or what dimension? What solar system? So the second set, for service providers. And this is really important. Choose free software for services. Release customizations to software under free software licenses. Meaning that someone can access this or create their own service that's similar. And allow data portability for a user's data. This is kind of boiled down, but you want someone to be able to control their own data, not make it necessarily public, unless that's your service. So, for example, and Google actually does a pretty good job of this. Like, you can export your data in a lot of their services and take it elsewhere, like your contacts or your email. You can export it, get it out, take it back to your, you know, your Pine or whatever you want to, you know, set up on your server. And then finally, for users, consider service options. Use services that follow this. Doesn't necessarily mean like religiously. And of course, spread news about this and get other people on board. So some of these things, and I was thinking about this, like, okay, you know, I'm like, I've been involved in these. I've kind of gone from Inkscape to like Open Clip Art Library, Open Font Library. Like, these kind of services, these are early versions of these. And this, I'm very committed to this now, like converting these sites into being compliant with Franklin Street Declaration. They're kind of formative in this. I'm showing the new interfaces. Some of this is like, Dave, this is the new Open Font Library. You're talking later today, right? About this. Oh, tomorrow. Okay, good. But this is like fun stuff, you know. This was developed before Web 2.0 and all these great web developments. But we have a lot to learn now from what's happened in the web communities, what we can apply to our own software and our own projects now. So if we look at what's been happening, right, we have all of our desktop applications, which are awesome. You know, we have like, you know, GIMP with like 2 million features and Inkscape with like 2 million features. Like, you can like draw like hexagonal like guides now. It's like crazy. You could do like triangular guidelines. It's so useful. That was a joke. Okay, never mind. No, it is useful. But I mean, it's a extended feature set. But now you're starting to see these different creative web applications pop up everywhere on the internet. Has anyone tried this, Aviary? They have a very like large goal. They have many different applications. I've seen them working. And experimental ones that you maybe just wouldn't develop. Now, you'd be so focused on, you know, getting your one desktop application to work because development's so much heavier. And they also have investment capital as well. So this is, Aviary is an online editor. They have vector, they have image, they also have like labs. They're very ambitious about what they're trying to do. So you can, very much like Inkscape, right? You have Bezier curves, you can edit, you can do all these things, you have layers. It's a simpler set, but it's functional, basic functionality. What's the markup though? And here's another application they have that's a kind of a scene editor, graph editor. So you can go in and experiment with shaders. They also have a graphics, like a bitmap editor, something maybe like the weakest version of GIMP you could make or something. But it's still functional. But why is that? You can share your files online. Maybe something like Open Clipart Library with an editor. There's social collaboration features you don't get in our desktop applications. So maybe you have less features, but more social functionality. There's a bit of a trade-off. Right now, at least. That's a really weird picture. Sorry. Kind of freaking me out a little bit. But then what you also have is you start to see with these models is you start to see a business behind it. Because hosting on a server is not just free, right? Electricity costs something. You have to pay for this somehow. Flickr, for example, right? It's like $25 a year for a pro account, unlimited uploads, and they handle the details. But isn't that similar to like paying for software? I mean, is this not? I mean, you don't get access to their code, but you're paying money every year or month. I mean, so you start to get this kind of like lock-in in some ways too. If there's not this covenant, this like contract with the users. Here's another one. Here's DocStock. DocStock is a document sharing service. And yet again, you can upload your documents here, and it has a social functionality where you can spread out your information, tag it, and others can find it. So what if you're working on some great document or graphics program if no one knows it exists, right? Is this not why we share our code? Do we just share it because of vanity or because we, you know, want to? I mean, there's some reputation involved in this. This guy's like really attentive. Other people are like starting to nod off. They're like, no, this cloud thing, get out of the cloud. Get into the rainstorm. Go outside. Picnic, this is another editor as well, but with another, they have APIs. There's these interfaces, but they're still hidden because you can't get the code. You can't get at it. So their functionality is hidden behind their API. And they also, of course, provide a business model, some sort of a payment. Other ones provide, like maybe they have advertising. Or maybe if you sell your file or sell your content, then they'll take a percentage of the profit out of it. Another one I use a lot is Scribd, or Scribd-y. It's kind of got this like Scribus thing going on. Wait, we should make the definitive. Is it Scribus or Scribus? Craig, what do you think? What? See, Scribus. Okay, so now nobody can do that anymore. We've heard it from the man. So Scribd is another great service. But also, there's all these like font editors popping up. And this is probably not the best one. Dave can probably tell you like a really good one, right, Dave? But font editing is a very challenging process, and I've grown to like have a great respect for the people in my Open Font Library who are really digging into this. But for the longest time, right, we've had like one or two font editors in the free and open space, and now you're starting to see, because web development is much easier, you're starting to see lots of experiments and web applications that allow for this type of font editing. And allows for a collaboration that hasn't existed in the past, except for maybe in like a lab or a studio. And my slides are going to be on SlideShare later too. So what we really need is this online creative software now, right? Doesn't exist. We don't have this kind of free and open creative applications out there on the web right now. So why is this like this? Why do these things, why is this win? Why is this winning? Like what will we gain by making more developments in this area? So I'm just going to say some like maybe things that are outrageous, and then you guys will like, you know, prove me wrong, but that's okay. I like that. But I will say that desktop development is too hard. Yes, you're right. Compatibility, your web, yeah, browser compatibility is definitely a challenge. But I'll say that desktop development is too hard. You get a lot more developers automatically by having web development, by using web development as your model. You might get bad coding practices, but I would argue that it's better to have more developers. Web development's easy. A lot of our applications are at a stage now where we're adding bells and whistles and trying to compete with what else is in the space. Like, how much more do we need? Like Windows, or not Windows, but Microsoft Word versus like Google Docs. Like, what do you really need to write like a dissertation or write just a paper? You need a text editor. You need template? You really do? I mean, can't you just, I mean, you just need a text editor like spell check, right? No? It has. Maybe like 10 years now. No, 6 years.
Do they have Word?
But no, seriously, like, what do you need? What do you really need? I mean, are the collaborative aspects of Google Docs or other writing services, there's more than just that. Do they outweigh the actual functionality that's needed? There'll be more functions, of course, but right now, what were you going to say? Citations.
Yeah, you really need some system for managing references, and I haven't seen that in Google Documents.
Yeah.
The only way I can do this is either by being a dirty geek and use LaTeX and BibTeX and Referencer and Subversion or Bazaar or some kind of version control.
Yeah.
And or OpenOffice with Zotero.
Yeah.
And Zotero, you can basically drag and drop stuff into Google Documents. It's not a reference that can be manipulated. Mm. And I would really like to see something like Google Documents with proper citations.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't want to be a Google fanboy either, but because I'm arguing basically that if the code for Google Docs was open, that if we wanted this functionality, we could hack it in or run our own service or contribute patches to that service. And there are other... there are open solutions to this, to like, you know, open document or web-based document editing that we could, any of us could add code to add citations or templates if we wanted to. In some ways, too, I mean, we're all set in our ways, too, about development. Like the OpenMoco project, I think, is a good example. I was really excited about OpenMoco. Like, oh, this is so great. There's not this open cell phone. But it was built in a very Unix-y way. And also, there's some other problems, too. But built on top of old infrastructure initially, which really stagnated the project. But then all of a sudden, you know, Android comes along and some other phone developments that are, they still use Linux, but they go ahead and pioneer and create something new on top of it. Of course, they have a lot more funding, and they've got Google behind it, and they bought the company that was already far along in development. But sometimes there's something to gain from jumping through these things. I'd also say that some of our community processes, OpenOffice, you know, are a little bit arcane and hard to break into. Some of the best projects, right, are just like so easy. You can just like submit a patch. Like if you just submit something through an email address, that'd be great, you know, no hassle. I think why so many people use Launchpad, right? But another thing, just to say, like, what, just to trumpet, like, web development, it's lower barrier for participation overall. There's more eyes, more users. More people can help out. But there's also, and I've grown to respect this from working at Creative Commons and working with businesses, there's a lot of investment money as well. Still, even now in this economy, there's still a lot of investment money. Even in Montreal, there's investment capital for doing web projects and making something that has a business behind it. And I think there's something to be said about escaping somewhat from being like totally free and open source zealot. You know, looking at like the common person, looking at like your friends and family and say, like, what do they need? Like, how can I like code with, not just for myself all the time? which, and I'm into that too. So we need to like kind of wake up a little bit, I think, about these things and jump in and participate in this, in the web development, in this kind of, in the cloud. So what are these missing pieces like in this creative space, creative web application space? And of course, there's going to be some complicated things like Blender 3D, you know, develop 3D development or desktop publishing that it's going to take a while to get there on the web. Yeah, right. Yeah. It's like things you never thought were possible, like just become possible, right? It's just really exciting. It's so exciting to be able to like travel around all these like APIs and like SDKs now. It's just like taken for granted. It's like being released daily, something new like this. So where are these missing pieces? And I'm not going to get too deep into this because I'm mainly just, you know, kind of trying to cover the whole issue set to disrupt discussion. The Autonomous Project has like a listing of services that don't exist, and there's just a huge hole in creative software, in creative applications. But I think it's something that needs to be thought of as well as a sustainable development. And this is kind of gets me down about Open Clip Art and Open Font Library, because they're web communities are so much maintenance. It's really hard to keep on it when you're like, you know, you just have to make money. So making a web business is great. You know, making something that's compliant, but also you're releasing code and as a service is brilliant for staying alive. Go ahead.
Let's take your ideas to logical extension. Essentially, what are you going to have? You're going to have an operating system in a browser, right? To do all the stuff that you want to do, you're going to have to replicate everything that's in a regular operating system.
No, I don't think so.
So you don't think so?
You can have a very thin operating system on a computer, right? And then have this kind of like buffer basically between that and a centralized service or a distributed service.
Right. I mean, I think the limit of what you're talking about is just creating another operating system in a different context. I mean, you're just recontextualizing the operating system now within a web browser.
Go ahead. No, go ahead. Jump in.
Have you written an operating system? Have you written an operating system? Yeah, there's a lot more to... he's talking about APIs. He's talking about... some of the functionality that would go into an operating system. He's not talking about disk management. He's not talking about memory management.
I don't care about that stuff.
There's a lot more that goes into an operating system than the GUI. Yeah.
I don't care about operating systems. I'm saying operating system just as like terminology used yesterday. All I'm talking about is making websites, basically, or web services.
Right, but what I'm saying is to have all this functionality available, you're going to have to get lower and lower level. You're just going to have to keep rolling more and more stuff into the browser to make it viable, right? So, I mean...
For example, there's a research project, I think it's a research project at Microsoft that's looking at rolling like process management type stuff into a web browser. And so you are starting to get some of this low-level operating system type stuff being...
That's why I put up the Google Chrome
browser.
Too, right?
Multi-threaded.
I mean,
I mean, we were just talking about OpenGL coming in there. And that's sort of, you're getting... lower and lower level APIs rolling into web browsers.
I'm not necessarily arguing for like making new operating system as much as making these services and cooperating or pushing the envelope on what's available in our ethos, what we all participate in. Go ahead.
The Web Applications Working Group, W3C, and then there's some other potential working groups at W3C that are doing these things. That's exactly what we're doing. We're making APIs to do things that traditionally have only been done in operating systems. It doesn't mean they're operating systems. It means that they're features that have traditionally been, things like drag and drop. What does that mean in a web context? We're defining that. You're exposing it, exactly. Browsers are already doing these things, right? We're just finding ways to expose those things. And also things like address management, address books and these sorts of things.
So then my question is why? I mean, what benefit are you going to get from this in the long run compared to making an operating system better?
Instead of being locked into one operating system,
No, wait, you can be locked into multiple web browsers, right? Go ahead.
I said the benefit of transferring these functions from the operating system to the web browser is that instead of being locked into a single operating system, now you can be locked into a single web browser.
Well, I mean, hopefully you're not locked into one web browser, right?
But that's the way it works, because when you have all of this complexity in the APIs, there's no way that 4, 5, 6 different web browsers are all going to get it just right.
It depends on how much you rely upon the web browser versus the server, right? I mean, and what's happening. But, I mean, regardless, I mean, this is happening, you know? I mean, this service, people are using these services more and more. Like, being able to have to exist in multiple locations with backups, with collaborative features is happening. So it's not a matter of, like, why. It's a matter of if any of us want to participate in it and to have some level of control and or activism in this space. Go ahead.
So I'm not going to argue that it's going in this direction. Yeah. It's definitely going in this direction. Yeah. But why is it going in the direction? What is it? Yeah. Why is this working?
Collaboration. So because it's reached critical mass. People live in multiple locations, and sharing international, global, geographically dispersed relationships is just the norm. You have your contact list. You know, you have your 150 people, and you before you're chatting with them, and now you're collaborating with them. Now there's Remix community. Now you're watching YouTube, and now you have a webcam, and now you're making a conversation with someone about some creative work. So it's really the logical extension of media and our tools, but also a kind of a deeper social connection with other people. That's what I would argue is what's happening. But let me keep moving here. Okay. So I mean I. Regardless of any kind of discussion about the philosophy of it or why or reasoning, I mean, personally, I'm interested in this as well as a model for sustainability and working and being able to do these things. I still get asked those questions, like probably you guys do. How do you make money? It's like, give me a break. Come on, we get hired by Intel and then they'll pay us money, right? No. But I mean, at some point we have to like decide on how we're going to survive. Yeah, exactly. And is that service valid? Is it who's running it? So let me just get through this, okay? I'm just going to keep plowing, and then we can talk some more. All right. So what we need to do is we need to kind of look at what pieces are needed. What can we do now in this space as FLOSS developers? And kind of outline what's there. I mean, we could do this on the Create space, on the Create project. We could also connect it up on Autonomous, which is a lot of people working, Free Software Foundation, other advocates, and those with good track records on making things succeed. This is the site. But also get hacking, get funding, and get going on these things. I mean, if anyone's interested in this, you know, I'd love to talk about this more. This is part of the reason I live in China too. Is like, you know, I have a company called Fabricators that does some development and investment like this in this space. So I'm very interested in doing this. And I've looked at things like what Ton and what Blender's doing. It's like, why are we not copying like this? This Blender Foundation, Blender Institute, so awesome and so great. I mean, you go to the offices there, and you're just like, I just want to work here. Like, this is like, I wish I had a dad like Tom, you know. I said that too. I spoke at the second open source movie at Peach, and I put up as like basically Tom is the coolest person out there. And he was like, he's like, us Dutch people, we really hate this. We cannot like be in the forefront like this. But I mean, really, it's a really great model. And we should look at it. So I mean, that's the basics of this, and I'll do this talk more and more, and hopefully there'll be some more developments out of it that are more concrete, which I'm always committed to. But let's talk and everything. I'm not going to have all the right answers either.
Does the Blender, using the Blender model, mean that you're going to raise a few million dollars in venture capital, hire lots of people to write a commercial software project, then go bankrupt and turn it into free software?
No, let's do the part afterwards. Let's start from free. Yeah. No, that's the extended story. But I don't mean that. I mean the kind of business brilliance of being able to support a bunch of people who want to have fun and make something cool. That's also useful.
Well, I mean, here's my problem with the model. I see this as an extension from the business direction, not as a natural extension from open source free software, because you're implying that there is an investment reason to put money into this. Well, what does that mean? We can see what it means. It means that you set up a system where you get part of this for free, but the rest you have to pay for.
I don't like that. I don't like that. But I mean, there has to be some business model.
That is why there is investment capital.
This is true.
If you remove the ability to collect money for having all these different kinds of software services, why are you going to have any investment in it? I mean, that's so we're
so one. I would argue that it's not an extension of business, and I would say that free software. There was software business before Free Software Foundation, right? You know, I mean, so that was another bolt-on. This is a reaction just like that. This autonomous and the Franklin Street Declaration is a reaction to that. So it's yes, there's investment, but we can do it in a way that is good and green and everything. You know, like social entrepreneurship. We can do it in a good way if we think about it, talk about it. But also this conference is not free. You know, like just because you have a nonprofit, like Creative Commons raises loads of money. It has to. Like if you call that a nonprofit, you can call it that. I mean, people are still paying dues in some way. I mean, we could probably divide up how much it costs for each person to be here. And I can either charge you for it or I can go get donations and we can feel better about it. But at the end of the day, things cost money. So better to put that out on the table and figure it out rather than like treat it like it's like a cancer.
John?
Yeah.
First one, kind of like just comment, and that is more and more kind of desktop development is moving also in the direction of like using JavaScript on the desktop as a way of like extending applications. Yeah. And personally, I believe that, well, creating user interfaces on a back end using JavaScript is kind of a good way to move because it like has more in common with.
It's not a good way.
Deb. What?
You said it's not.
I think it's a good way to move, but that is not what I actually want to say. Do you like books?
Good question.
I'm talking about these paper things that don't need batteries, that you can take into the forest, out of civilization. You can open them and read them.
No, I've recently started liking books again because I picked up some. There's this term in Chinese, Shanjai, which means like knockoff, it means like mountain village because it's like accessible products for people who live up in the mountain. Nobody cares, right? It's like they're in the mountain. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, but
anyway, I picked up some books for a dollar.
Yeah,
that were knockoffs.
Yeah, my kind of commentary is that you buy a book, you don't have to get batteries to run it.
True.
You don't need to hook it up to the grid to get access to your data.
Yeah, that's true.
And I would demand, if I were even kind of buying into this idea, that, well, such a service that is kind of online editing and they have backend and such, I would demand the ability to, at the push of a button, migrate server and data to local web server so I can go into the forest where there's no internet and continue to do my creating and my authoring.
Yeah.
If you lock me into having to be online, tethered to the cloud, it's like, well, that limits my ability to create.
Totally. I mean, if you think about it, a book is just an exported file anyway, right? It's just an atrophied copy of something digital.
I'm thinking more about the tool as an artifact that runs and works. You can read it without batteries. You don't have to be online to read a physical book.
Yeah, I don't know about you guys, but I'm like sick of like sitting at a desk. Like I've been like standing up. I make speakers, so I've been making this big like subwoofer, and I like work at it in China in this like studio like all day. And it's so great because I just have like bass like pounding against me and I'm like working. But I'm completely, yes, great, you know, go offline. Google Gears, AKA like a book, yeah, you know.
Well, I would actually demand it to like, you need local servers so I can go completely off
completely.
The network and without
it. Yeah, I mean a book is a lossy backup, right?
Without such functionality, software as a service is not software freedom.
I agree, but Software as a service does not suffer freedom, but if we do it in the right way, we can make it more free and have better ability to do this one-touch backup.
But, well, in order to do this as free software projects, well, right now you have some kind of support, you have SourceForge, you have Launchpad, you have a couple of sites where you can host for free. They provide all the infrastructure, mailing list. Well, we are lucky that we don't have to do all this on ourselves, but in order to make something like Flickr or GIMP Online, there should be similar kind of access to to file storage and so on if you want to create a free
Before the GNOME Online desktop, there was like a big push to have this like, you know, GNOME server infrastructure where you can trust what you're doing. I mean, think about like App Engine, right? Google App Engine. It's you can compute on their servers. I mean, when are like all of us going to have a computing grid the size of Google? You know, I mean, so I think it's cool, and we should look at ways to have something like, you know, the Open Source Lab or something support some services that we trust as a way to get this rolling, but then really use it as advocacy to get Google and others to support this Creative Commons, kind of like how Creative Commons did it. I totally cut you off, probably what you're going to say, but sorry. Any other? Okay. Okay, it's fine. Okay, well, if there's one more, then one more. If not, then let's go and, was it lunchtime?
It is lunchtime, but we have another talk.
Okay, oh yeah, that's right. Okay, cool. Well, we can talk later.